السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Welcome to episode 40. Today the Sheikh is going to talk to us all about the leading role of women in Islam. This is such an important topic and it really spreads a message. I want you all to think about what the Sheikh is going to talk to us today and really try and spread the message for all your other friends and family. Men and women are all different, but we should all be treated the same. And now we're going to see what the Sheikh says and what he has to think about this. Please remember to write us your questions for us to answer and share and like with all your family and friends. Sheikh, it's your time to shine.
Thank you. جزاكم الله خير. شكرا. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على أشرف المرسلين. سيدنا محمد وآله أجمعين. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري. واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. رب أوزعنا نشكر نعمتك التي أنعمت علي وعلى والدي ونعمل صالحا ترضاه وأصلح لي في ذريتي إني تبت إليك وإني من المسلمين. My dear brothers and sisters in Iman, my sons and daughters, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. As just you have heard, today's subject is important. For me personally, it is important because it reminds me of great men who lived not for themselves, not even for their own families, but they lived for humanity. For men who were nurtured and brought up and looked after by women. Yet, in our world today, when a man is seen to be weak, people tend to say, "Tarbiyat niswan, he was just raised by women." Little they know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given women a very special position and place within his kingdom. Today's verse of the Quran from Surah Al-Hujurat. And I advise everybody to recite this surah and read the meaning of it because it talks about relationships. Not very long, but beautiful. Verse 13, it speaks about men and women. And listen to what Allah the Almighty says. Ya ayyuha an-nas, O you people, inna khalaqnakum min dhakarin wa unsa. We have created you from a male and a female. وَجَعَلْنَاكُمْ شُعُوبًا وَقَبَائِلَ لِتَعَارَفُوا And we made you into nations and tribes so that you can get to know one another. إِنَّ أَكْرَمَكُمْ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ أَتْقَاكُمْ Indeed, the most noble, most honorable before Allah is the one who is most upright, honest, truthful, and decent, avoiding all that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala dislikes or has forbidden. إِنَّ اللَّهَ خَبِيرٌ Alim. Allah is most aware, all knowledgeable. Some of us tend to put faith to things so that people can see them. They are inclined that way. For example, that they respect women, but behind the scene, they are not. And that's what Allah dislikes. The hadith of Rasulullah for today will give us even a better understanding of the importance of women to Allah Almighty subhanahu wa ta'ala and to Rasulullah sallam. قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يا معشر الرجال The messenger peace be upon him said O you gathering men استوصوا خيرا بالنساء I remind you to always be good to women not to your women not to your household women no to women in general This indicates to me from this instruction that every woman that walks on this earth deserves that khair, inshallah. Question that always arise to me, I don't know about you, but to me, من هي المرأة? Who is this woman? وما دورها? And what is her role? And what was her condition before Islam? If you ask me, personally for me, what is a woman? Who is a woman? She is my mother. She is my grandmother, my auntie, ammati, my auntie from my mother, khalati. She is my wife. She is my daughter. And most important, she is my sister. That is very, very important and dear. But unfortunately, we don't see the women that way. But this is the way I see women. Without her, I would not be here. And what is her role? When a nikah is done in Islam or in any religion of the book, there is a sermon. It tells us what the nikah is, what are the rites of the religion of the nikah, what's supposed to be done, not to be done, and then the role of the mother and the role of the father, the responsibilities for both. Unfortunately, today in our Muslim environment, a nikah is done and you come invited, and when you ask them, oh, it's finished, they sign the papers. It doesn't make sense. Those people gathered for what? They should be reminded. أين خطبة النكاح? I did too many nikahs in my life. I will never do a nikah without a theremin. To remind myself and those who are sitting before me, and most important, the husband and wife, for their roles. The only thing I have learned, the role of the woman is the most noblest. She is responsible for the new life by carrying it in pain, by delivering it in pain, by looking after it from the day it is born until it is buried, worried and frightened for all condition that person will find themselves in, male or female. And indeed, women look more after the men than the women of the household, which is strange. Because this is the way the men tend to think it should be done. Let me remind you, this woman carries in herself what Allah called Ar-Rahim, an identical creation of Allah next to the throne, made of light, called Ar-Rahim. It makes one prayer. Oh Allah, link me to those who link to their next of kin, and cut me off, or cut your mercy from those people who sever or cut their relationship with their next of kin. That's the importance of this. Ar-Rahim is the source of Rahmah. From his name, the Rahman al-Rahim, subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the initial role of the woman generally is to carry out her baby. Once it is born, to look after it, to cater for it, to nurture it, and to do all in her ability to bring this child to be a representative of Allah on this earth. Truthful, honest, kind, generous, gentle, and moreover, upright, realizing his vertical relationship with Allah and the duties horizontally with everyone and everything living on this earth. The best of men, among the most pious, behind them are the best women. I know that. I know that from my own life. That is it. Without a good mother, a good wife, a good daughter, a good sister, a good grandmother or auntie, we're lost. How was her condition before Islam? In Jahiliya, Arabia, she had no rights. In living even her life, her father, her brother, her uncle, grandfather, or her husband could take her life anytime he wants. Why? Because she's a property. She used to be inherited. When the man dies, all the women are shared. Not that. She used to be caught from wherever. Even if she's the daughter of a sultan, once she's caught and sold in the market, and she's marked, she's a slave. Even if her father comes back, he cannot take her back. As if there was a common understanding, they are not good for nothing but to be abused. To that extent, they named her Rijsun min amal al-shaytan, an evil of the work of shaytan. This is in Arabia, and the worst thing, because they used to be ashamed when one of them is reminded or given the good tidings, a daughter is born, he used to get angry. And therefore, he used to take the daughter and bury her alive. Allah, where are they going to stand before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the day of judgment? This is in Arabia. What used to happen in other nations at that time? I'll give you examples. Because a lot of people today say, this is the Muslim, treat women like that. No, the whole world. In India, they used to believe women are a disease. Women are death. Women are the hellfire. Women are poison. Women are snakes. They used to believe that fire is better than women. and she is filth and dirt. She should not eat the best of food. And she should never speak publicly to any gathering where even there is one man. And she is only good for entertaining men. Use her to satisfy shaitan, ill and evil desires. In France, this land of liberty, land of democracy, as they say, they talk about us as Muslim not treating our women. When Islam was salvaging women from what the Jahiliyyah used to do, in France, in the 6th century, the scholars of the land, the men, gathered to debate. To debate what? You might laugh. هل المرأة إنسان أم لا? Is women humans or not? What a stupid question to ask. What can a man stand and ask whether his mother, that means you are yourself. But this is serious. They came to a conclusion in their meeting, she the woman, but she was only created to serve men, nothing else. She had got no other. Our country, England, King Henry VIII, he reduced women to a position whereby today we will laugh at. It is haram for them to read the Bible. Forbidden. They are not members of the society whereby they can become citizens. So they are not citizens of the country. That means they cannot travel and do as they like. They cannot own anything. They cannot inherit until the beginning of the 20th century, when women came out in the early 20th century, tying themselves with chains, crying for freedom, just to vote. Think about that. And we are told we treat women as third class. And what made me laugh, today the country that everybody look at as the most advanced, most rich, Switzerland, women has no right, even the vote, it was given to them in 1972. I can give many, many examples. But this I chose because in these three countries, people look up to the advancement they have achieved. Let me tell you one thing. Islam has come to remove all the obstacles women used to have. Forbidden that women be mistreated so that they are not treated equally to men. Women will be put in a position whereby they are sold like any assessor, any mata' or any belonging of somebody. For sure, not to be inherited. What a stupid thing to do. But Islam raised their status and commanded their respect. The Prophet ﷺ says, Al-Jannatu tahta aqdam al-ummahat, paradise is beneath the feet of the mothers. That is an honor. And when one man came to ask him, which of my parents did they have most of my respect? He said, Ummuka, thumma ummuka, thumma ummuk. Your mother, your mother, your mother. Then your father. Allahu Akbar. This is our messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The man who became the savior, not just for women, for every mazlum, for every oppressed. The man whom everybody looked up to. And in the modern world, when they decided to choose which of the best leaders of humanity was number one, they chose Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam because they couldn't find any fault. Because if you are honest, you will not find any fault. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam gave women the chance to sit with him, with the men sit in front of him, the women in the back. Then the women said to him, Ya Rasulullah, we want to come closer to you so that we're not interrupted by others. And subhanallah, he made them a special day, just women, come and sit with him. As far as I know, over 7,000 women listened to him speak to them. Of them, 700 women became reporters who reported knowledge, like Aisha and Hafsa and Asma and many I can name. They all reported hadith and knowledge from Rasulullah Sallam. There are books written in Islam long time ago. Kutubun Nisa, the book of women, the greatest women in Islam. Khadija radiallahu ta'ala anha, Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, Fatima radiallahu ta'ala anha. But Islam did something even greater. Islam made a clear understanding that there is no distinction between men and women when it comes to worship and when it comes to spirituality. Yes, physically they are different. They have different role to play. Listen to this in Surah An-Nahl, verse 97. Allah says subhanahu wa ta'ala, أَعُوذُ بِاللَّهِ مِنَ الشَّيْطَانِ الرَّجِيمِ مَنْ عَمِلَ صَالِحًا Whosoever does any righteous good action. مِنْ ذَكَرٍ أَوْ أُنْثَى Be it be male or female, وَهُوَ مُؤْمِنٌ and they are believers, فَلْنُحْيَنَّهُ حَيَاةً طَيِّبًا We will allow them to live a good life. وَلَنَجْزِيَنَّهُمْ أَجْرَهُمْ بِأَحْسَنِ مَا كَانُوا يَعْمَلُونَ However, we will reward them from what we have, the best of what they have done. Islam says spiritually, no. The salah of the man is like the salah of the woman. Hajj and fasting and everything, there is no difference. Somebody might say, they don't pray all the month. Yes, because they have another role physically to play by carrying children, need to prepare themselves. So monthly, maybe they have 5 or 6 or 7, whatever it is. So they are not supposed to pray because Allah allows that, but they are equal. Any man says otherwise, they don't understand. I'm 100% sure there is no difference between them and men spiritually. In fact, there are women more greater than men. Allah praised them in the Quran. After all, Allah named the whole surah, a whole chapter, An-Nisa, the women. Allahu Akbar. To show us their important role that they need to play. And also, He, subhanahu wa ta'ala, gave other surahs names like Maryam in the Quran. Very, very important to think of these things. And Allah spoke about those women with absolute beautiful language. So, we need to think carefully how we should treat women. What upset me today, some of us as men, we try to treat women equally, but yet they're not equal. She's going to work and you are going to work, but yet she comes home, she has to go to the kitchen and clean and cook and look after the children, and we put our feet on the table and demand. Who are we demanding from? Our servants? Our slaves? Or our jawari that we bought from the market? Or women that we brought from the market? If this woman you are calling, is not she your wife, your daughter, your mother, your auntie? Rasulullah Sallam says clearly, خيركم خيركم لأهله. The best of you is the one who is best to his women. وأنا خيركم لأهله. I am the best for my women. And in the seerah it is written, and everybody reads it. But we don't act upon it. كان رسول الله سلم يسير في خدمة أهله بسيرة سنية. He صلى الله عليه وسلم used to help his family at home, his women, and while he's finding joy helping them and supporting them. We need to change our ways. Women are not to be abused. Women are not to be mistreated. Women are not to be treated like slaves. If a man is working and a woman sitting at home, yes, she can help him by doing the roles, the chores. Her role is to look after the children. His role is to earn the living. What about the chores of cooking, cleaning, washing? It should be a shared responsibility. We were brought up like that. I don't know about you, but we were brought up like that. To help and support and stand, for they are not my slaves. If I honor them, I will not mistreat them. And I honor my mother and I honor my father. And let me tell you a short story of a very beautiful woman, a woman that all of us should think about. and respect and look up to. And this woman is called Fatima Zahra, Fatima bint Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Fatima bint Muhammad alayhi afdal as-salatu wa salam. Fatima was a woman whom Rasulullah sallam used to get up to welcome her when she came to him. He will never leave to travel outside Medina unless he goes to her house first, then go to the masjid, then leave. When he come back, go to the masjid first to pray. Why does he go to masjid? To pray, to thank Allah when he's coming, and to ask Allah to protect him in his journey. And then he come to Fatima, then he come to his house. But she was living a poor life. She had very little. She's the daughter of the emperor, the ruler, the sultan, the master, the king of the world. Allahu Akbar. But still she was poor, because he doesn't put anybody before the people or the public. I wish our leader today will learn from this. One day they will have nothing at home to eat or drink. Fatima felt so sad, and she never embarrasses her husband. She knows when there is work, he work and bring living. She have a piece of material, a garment. She said, take this and sell it. I think the price for it should be 6 dirhams, and buy food for us and come back. He took it and rushed out. The moment he left, a poor man met him. Oh, cousin of Rasulullah. Oh, beautiful man. Oh, man of the Prophet house. Please help me. Guess what? He didn't say to him, look, I don't have. This is not my money. Or gave him a dirham or two. He gave him all of it. Said, take it. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. He is doing business with Allah, where no loss will come. The woman at home, she's a good woman. She's not going to question him and tell him, what did you do, and shout at him. No. And he's a good man. He will never mistreat her. While he's walking, wondering what to do, what am I going to do with Fatima and the food? A man meet him, an old man, holding a beautiful camel. Oh, Ali, what's wrong with you? Don't you want to? You like animals, you like horses, and this camel is so beautiful. It's for sale, for sale. Who did you buy it? And you can make profit in it. Ali looked at this, he liked it, he said, but I don't really have the money. He said, look, take it. When you sell it, bring me my money. How much you sell it for? 100 dirhams. Ali took it, and he was walking with it. Then he realized, what big trouble I'm in now. I have a camel, and I have to pay this loan. And I lost 6 dirham, and I have got no food at home. While he's walking, whispering to himself, praising Allah and thanking him for his condition, a man meet him. Oh, mashallah, ya Ali, you have a beautiful camel. Where did you get it from? Wouldn't you sell it for me? Would you buy it? He said, of course I'll buy it. How much do you want for it? Ali said to him, 160. He said, this is it. Ali took the 160 and went and gave the first man 100 and took the 60 and went home. Listen to this, because today there are women who will tell their husband, look at him. He's going and working, and look how much money he's bringing and buying his children. But listen, my wife, I respect you. He's taking bribery. So what? Are you better than bribery? Take it. But I don't want to bring haram home. Allahu Akbar. Look at Fatima, this great leading woman. This great leading woman, when Ali came to her, well, Fatima, mashallah, and he threw the money in her laps. She threw it away. What is this? I gave you 6 dirhams to buy food. This is too much money. Where did you get it from? What did you do? Ibn Abi Talib. She was so frightened. He did something wrong. Maybe he went and gambled. No, no, don't worry. He told her the story. She was still astonished, and suddenly the door knocks, and who comes but the shining light of the world, the leading man who brought justice to women in the world, the one who taught her to be a decent, upright woman, the one who told her, I will not stand in the day of judgment to act anything but just with you, Fatima. And in this world, if you steal, I will chop your hand. She respected the laws here, and she acted in the right way to save her life in the hereafter. And Fatima looking sad. Why are you looking sad? She told the Prophet that stirred the Prophet that said, Fatima, don't be sad. Ya Ali, did you know who sold you the camel? He said, no. Did you know who bought it? No. He said, these are two angels. Allah has sent them to test you and to see how would you react. And Allah has informed me, he's so pleased with you. So he held Fatima, he held Ali, and he says, نحن آل البيت. We are the family of the Prophet. In another hadith, he said to Fatima, Fatima, أنت بضعة مني. You are a part of me. وأنا بضعة منك. And I'm a part of you. These are the leading women that we need to look up to. Their husband didn't say to them, just sit at home and work and do the cooking. Did not refuse them to travel and go. Did not show them the disrespect that we see men doing today. And the saddest thing, I see some men, they want to get married. They see the woman not wearing hijab. They want to marry her. The moment she gets married, oh, you should put your hijab on. Why didn't you ask her before she gets married? Why? You liked her then, and now you are putting your rules? Where are your rules? Or promising her, you can continue your education, you can continue your work. The moment she comes home, now you are my wife, you are not allowed. You made a promise. And I remind every woman, in the marriage certificate, there is an area for condition. And you have the right to make condition of nikah. Any condition. In the Quran, Allah said, Shu'aib made condition for Musa. In order for him to marry one of his daughters, to stick with him for 8 years, and it will be better for him to stay 10 years. Because he didn't know Shu'aib was going to teach him from a Fir'aun who came from Egypt or a son of Fir'aun to return back a messenger who will bring out the children of Israel. And Sayyidina Muhammad Sallam, when Ali wanted to marry Fatima, he made a condition. She will not accept a second wife. I will not allow you to take a second wife with her. You want her? She will be your only wife. Either she died or you die, and that's it. If she died before you, you can get married. But otherwise, no. Even when a tribe came to cheat him to marry, Allahu Akbar, the Prophet jumped to the member when he heard the news and called those people and says, it will not take place. For he gave me his word. Because he cared for his daughter Fatima. Didn't want her heart to be broken. My brothers, my sisters, let us train our children properly. And the final thing I will say, especially for my people from Sudan, please let us respect our women. Two things that hurt me. Women's circumcision, it has no place in Islam. Our men never allow that in our homes in Sudan. Generation, we don't allow that. Not allowed. They say it is from the Sunnah. If it is from the Sunnah, the Prophet should have done it for his daughters. And it should have been done for all the Muslims. There is no more Muslim than in Asia. Not one single Asian country has it. They follow every Sunnah. Why they don't follow this Sunnah if it is? They work hard for the honor of their women. But women are responsible for this. You need to stop it yourself. The other thing, we need not to favor the children and put the best food for them. And we need to put them fairies to eat. Why? We should all sit together and treat our daughters equally with our children so that they can be raised to be good mothers. For without good mothers, there will never be a future for men. Jazakum Allah khair. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi ta'ala wa barakatuh.
Jazakallah khair, ya Sheikh.
Shukran.
We now have a few questions for you, and inshallah, we'll then have time to do the dua.
Inshallah.
The first question is, what should you do if someone treats you differently?
As a woman, if any man treats you differently in the sense that not allowing you to live your life without committing what is forbidden, it depends who the person is. If he is older than you, your father, your grandfather, your uncle, your older brother, you talk to them. Show me your evidence. What I'm supposed to do is wrong in Islam. If they have no evidence, they have no chance. There are some people who come and say to me, women are not supposed to travel alone. A woman needs a mahram. Although the same woman, every day, leave her house, take the train, take the bus to go to work and bring the money and the food and nobody asks her. The moment she wants to travel, Rasulullah said there will come a time a woman can travel from Bisra, okay, and go to a place called Al-Hayra by Kuwait and come and do her Umrah or Hajj and return and nothing will harm her. Women should be respected. But women should also realize Allah made men responsible for women. So they should make sure that because they are not harmed, because the harm that comes to women come from the men. Who buys the women? Who sells the women? Who oppress the women? It's men. So if your father or your uncle or your grandfather or your husband or your older brother try to negotiate with you, yes, be open. So that your security is very important. My wife is going out, she'll tell me. I'm going here, so I know. When she's away, she will ring me. My daughter will do the same thing, so that we know where they are, because we are responsible for them. But we will never mistrust them, because we respect them.
JazakAllah khair. The next question is, it's not nice to treat people differently, but if someone is having trouble and you feel bad for them, is that an exception?
Yes, sometimes يعني we feel sad. It depends. We are living in the Western world, whereby there are a lot of different things. If, for example, a woman is being abused, and especially now we are locked down, a lot of people who drink and take drugs are just born angry and they have no respect for men. There is a lot of oppression at home. I just did a talk with a group of scholars 2 days ago. It was beautiful. Activists from the social work, men and women were talking about women being oppressed during this lockdown. And you can't believe it, thousands of people are listening across the world. Amazing. And what we said found ears and heart to absorb it and to understand it. So I believe in my heart of heart, we should always seek advice. For example, I'm living in England and I know somebody from my family, from my community. The woman has been oppressed in that house, or the daughter has been mistreated. You will try first to gain full understanding that is true, what is happening. Then I will approach the person responsible and try to advise them. Then if nothing happened, I will try to find some of their members, their families, to do something. The saddest thing for me, one day, many women come to me from my own country. A woman came to me, she's young, she just came from her country. She just had one or two children, and her husband used to beat her up at home. She came to my school and she was crying. Well, usually I get just people of the school. Who are you? Have you got children? No, no, I just heard about you. And this is what happened to me. And the sad thing, the man who used to be supposed to be a religious man. I said to her, go back to him and said to him, show me the evidence that the Prophet ﷺ ever lifted his hand to hit any of his daughters or his wife. And if it is, hit me more. He couldn't find. Who told you this? Just forget about it. You show me. He can't show her. And he think he's following the Prophet ﷺ. He's not following the Prophet ﷺ. We're all following just our own egos, doing the wrong things and bringing Islam to disrepute. We are the worst representative to Islam. If we live Islam properly and honor our women and raise our children properly and have home that full of love and mercy, we will conquer this world, inshallah.
Inshallah, JazakAllah khair. The next question is, Lena, what are your plans for Eid? If you don't mind me answering this one.
Yes.
My plans for Eid, shukran ya Sheikh, is I'm going to try and spend as much time as I can with my family and inshallah do some jama'ah prayers and just have a fun time, inshallah. Inshallah. And the next question for you, Sheikh, is where can we see the talk you did a couple days ago about women?
If you can go to Imams Online Facebook page. Imams Online Facebook page. Inshallah, you find it there, or you find the link for it, inshallah.
Inshallah. The next question is, what about men who misquote the beat you wife verse?
Well, those men do not understand the Quran. I say this all the time. Language is very, 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 very difficult for many people to understand. Allah uses in the verse the word daraba, wadribuhunna, wadribuhunna. Now, the word daraba is used also in the Quran in different places, like wadrib lahum mathalan, or wadrib lahum tariqan fil bahri yabasa. Here it means avoid or keep away from. If Allah wanted them to be beaten up, He will use the same thing as he used for beating the drunken or beating the adulterer. Allah said, وَالسَّارِغَ وَالسَّارِغَ فَجْلِدُوا. Allah used the word jald. And therefore, this is the misunderstanding. And even some of the scholars who try to say, well, we mean it, but with the miswak. What a nonsense. How could you hit a woman or anybody with muswak? Muswak is so little. That they try to bring an understanding which I don't understand. If my Prophet did not use this, his wife did a lot of things. The Quran told him, if they want a divorce, divorce them. But he didn't tell him, beat them up. They are not animals. Even the animals we should not mistreat. That is really sad. I can't really believe our Prophet, the source of mercy, the one who brought the Quran for us as a mercy, from Allah, the most merciful, the all mercy, to ask us to beat. How could we beat our mothers, our sisters? Doesn't make sense. I wasn't ever brought up like that. And for your knowledge, the Prophet respected women so much. He was raised, first when he was born, with him, his mother, and a woman called Thuwayb al-Aslamiyya. She was breastfeeding him with her mother. And then took our such a country with Halima al-Sa'adiyya. When he was returned back, another woman took care of him with his mother called Baraka Umayman al-Habashiyya. When his mother died, Halima and Thuwayba and Baraka, he used to call them mothers. In fact, Baraka, the last one, when he used to see her coming, he would stand up, take his shawl, put it on the ground for her to walk on it and sit like a red carpet. What a decent human being. What an understanding of how to respect those people whom your life is in their hands. Women, to me, they are the place whereby love, gentleness, kindness, and all the beautiful things you can say about life. Rasulullah says, do not mistreat them. They're like glass. If you abuse them, you shatter them. This is what the Prophet said. Look at the language he uses. إِنَّهُنَّ كَالْقَوَارِيرِ. Don't mistreat women. Treat them with respect. You will live a life of dignity and honor, inshallah.
Inshallah. Jazakallah khair. That was the very last question. Please may now read us all a du'a.
Yes, I will say to everybody listening, we have agreed, inshallah, and to do Eid khutbah. And after Eid khutbah, inshallah, we'll have salat to Eid. Okay, every family, everybody prays in their home because we cannot gather together. But the khutbah will be. So I'm reminding everybody, please send this link to everybody. So on Eid day, whether it's Saturday or Sunday, 10 o'clock, we will start with Takbir al-Eid, inshallah. And then about 20 past, we start the khutbah for 25-30 minutes. And then everybody will do Salat al-Eid. And then, inshallah, we'll have a special program for Eid with some nasheed and singing and thing to make families rejoice with us, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the Quran, when we receive this, we should rejoice and be happy. قُلْ بِفَضْلِ اللَّهِ وَبِرَحْمَتِهِ فَبِذَلِكَ فَلْيَفْرَحُوا. Say to them, O Muhammad, when they receive bounties from us, or extra bounties and mercy, they should rejoice, inshallah. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين. اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد وعلى آل سيدنا محمد وسلم. يا الله يا رحمن يا رحيم يا أرحم الراحمين يا أرحم الراحمين يا أرحم الراحمين. رفعت أكفي إليك صفرا يا رب، إلا ما عفوت عنا وغفرت لنا ورحمتنا. تقبل منا الصيام والقيام، واجعلنا من الآمنين يوم الرجف والزلزال يا كريم. اللهم ربي لأمهاتنا وأخواتنا وجداتنا وعماتنا وخالاتنا وأزواجنا وبناتنا، اللهم ربي لهن كلا جميعا إلا ما عفوت عنهم يا كريم. اغفر لهم وارحمهم وبارك لهم ويسر لهم المضطهدات منهن يا ربي في بيوت لا نعلم أين هي وليس لهن مخرج يا رب. أما يجو المضطر، نحن مضطرين أن ندعوك أن تخفف عنهم يا كريم، وجعل ذلك من ذنان حسناتهم يا رحم الراحمين. Oh Allah, I pray and I ask you from my heart to send the best of blessing to Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with your salawat, and to accept our prayer for all the oppressed women all over the world. Oh Allah, remove their oppression. Oh Allah, allow them to have the dignity of living. Oh Allah, allow the women of the world to stand upright and to do the right thing by not dishonoring themselves in any way, but bringing honor to themselves and their children and their families, ya Kareem. Oh Allah, we ask of you for the suffering people because of corona, wherever they might be, may you save them and give them shifa. And those who passed away, may you forgive them. And all those who are in the front lines, in hospices, all people home, or any place where they dwell. Oh Allah, save them, protect them, guard them, and repay them handsomely from ourselves. Wa salli Allahumma ala Sayyidina Muhammadin wa ala Sayyidina Muhammadin wa barik wa sallim. Subhana rabbika rabbil izzati amma yasifun. Wa salamun ala al-mursaleen. والحمد لله رب العالمين. جزاكم الله خير الجزاء، والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله تعالى وبركاته.
بنحلم بفضاء أوسع، بنحلم بزمن أجمل، بلاد ميلاد، بلاد ميلاد.